And French President Emmanuel Macron is the latest world leader to visit Israel. Speaking alongside Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu, Macron said the common enemy of France and Israel is terrorism. He says an international coalition fighting against Islamic State in Iraq and Syria should be widened to include the war against Hamas.
This cost is just, period. Hamas is a terrorist group whose very objective is the destruction of the State of Israel. This is also the case for Daesh, Al-Qaeda, and those associated through their actions and intentions. The priority, your priority, but also that of all democracies and of France, is to defeat these terrorist groups with you. The fight must be merciless, but not without rules, because we are democracies which fight against terrorists. Democracies which therefore respect the laws of war and ensure humanitarian access. Democracies which do not target civilians, or Gaza, or anywhere.
Netanyahu, meanwhile, vowed to destroy Hamas, calling his country's fight against the militant group a test for the West and for civilization.
Hamas is responsible for civilian casualties, but we will do every effort to avoid them to fight this war as speedily and as rapidly as we can, but it could be a long war. If Hamas emerges victorious, we will all lose. Europe will be endangered. Everyone will be endangered. Civilization will be endangered. So if Hamas wins, if Hamas loses and is defeated, then the forces of civilization win. That is why this battle is not merely our own. It's Europe's battle. It's America's battle. It's civilization's battle. It's the battle for the heart and soul and the future of the Middle East and the Arab world.
After visiting Israel, Macron also met with Palestinian President Mahmoud Abbas in Ramallah. Over in the U.S., the White House rejects a ceasefire in the ongoing Israel-Hamas war. It says a truce at this stage would only benefit Hamas militants. But the White House says a humanitarian pause is needed to allow the safe deliveries of aid to civilians in Gaza. The U.S. is negotiating with Israel, Egypt, and the U.N. to ensure smooth emergency deliveries into Gaza.
We have said, continue to say, that fuel is an important commodity for life and sustainment in Gaza for the Palestinian people that are still there. And we know that fuel is a precious commodity that's running out, and you need it for generators in hospitals. You need it to run the desalination pumps so that you can drink fresh water and not seawater. All of that is important. And so we're going to continue to work with partners in the region. We're going to continue to push for fuel to get in. We want, as I said from the beginning, we want to see all measure of protection for civilians.
The chief of the United Nations pleading for the safety of civilians in Gaza, UN Secretary General Antonio Guterres, says the UN Security Council must act urgently to ease the spiraling conflict in the Middle East. He reminds all concerned parties war has rules, which starts with respecting and protecting civilians. Guterres also reiterating his call for a two-state solution to the conflict.
Let me be clear. No party to an armed conflict is above international humanitarian law. To ease epic suffering, make the delivery of aid easier and safer, and facilitate the release of hostages, I reiterate my appeal for an immediate humanitarian ceasefire. Excellencies, even in this moment of grave and immediate danger, we cannot lose sight of the only realistic foundation for a true peace and stability, a two-state solution. Israelis must see their legitimate needs for security materialized, and Palestinians must see their legitimate aspirations for an independent state realized.
The urgent appeal from the UN chief comes as Gaza records its highest 24-hour death toll since the war began. Over 700 Palestinians killed in Israeli airstrikes in a single day. The death toll in Gaza now stands at nearly 5,500, including 2,000 children. The humanitarian crisis is deepening for the 2.2 million people trapped inside the enclave. Doctors are now reporting outbreaks of diseases caused by overcrowding and poor sanitation among those displaced. A desperate appeal from Filipinos trapped in the Middle East, some 136 Filipinos and their families in southern Gaza, rushing to return home amid a series of Israeli bombardments and dwindling supplies. Foreign nationals have yet to pass the Rafah border in Egypt, which is the only way out of the besieged enclave.
Delikado po ang buhay namin dito at saka kulang sa tubig, sa pagkain. 1D1H lang po kami dito kasi sinitipid po namin ang mga pagkain pati tubig po. Ang hirap. Kasi nakakatakot po ang kalagayan namin dahil maraming bumbahan po dito.
In other parts of the region, over 20 Filipinos in the West Bank and 100 more in Israel are seeking repatriation. Meanwhile, 95 Filipinos want to leave Lebanon amid simmering tensions there. Former U.S. President Donald Trump and his former lawyer Michael Cohen trading barbs during their first face-to-face encounter at a New York fraud trial. Cohen testified against Trump, claiming the former president inflated his net worth to secure more favorable loan terms.
Let me just turn around and say that this is not about Donald Trump versus Michael Cohen or Michael Cohen versus Donald Trump. This is about accountability, plain and simple, and we leave it up to Judge Engoron in order to make all the determinations on that.
But Trump has firmly denied any wrongdoing, calling Cohen a liar. The result of the trial could lead to the dismantling of Trump's business empire as he seeks to regain the presidency in 2024.
A proven liar, as you know, is a felon, served a lot of time for lying, and we're going to just go in and see, and I think you'll see that this afternoon, the Southern District came out with a scathing statement about him. So he's a liar, trying to get a better deal for himself, but it's not going to work. This case, by any other judge, this case would have been over a long time ago. We did nothing wrong, and that's been proven.
Free legal services and resources now available to Filipino caregivers in Vancouver, Canada. More from Rowena Papasin.
I want to lose my job, of course, because I have my family in the Philippines.
Despite the many changes to the law to protect caregivers in Canada, many of them still suffer from isolation and abuse from their employers. Community leader Lina Vargas says it happened to her too when she was still a caregiver, an ordeal experienced by many care workers to this day.
Yung mga abuse na gano'n, yung exploitation, yung too much work, and then they are not get paid properly. Until now, I know and I learned na still going on pala. Wow, sabi kong ganyan, dapat turuan na natin sila.
Vargas explains this incident happened because many caregivers are not fully aware of their rights. This is why the nonprofit group Filipino BC launched Casina, a new program where caregivers can come together to tell their stories, share a meal, and listen to caregiver advocates.
A program like this that is led by former caregivers for current caregivers gives access to hope, solidarity, and tangible services that will directly benefit those care workers that are made vulnerable by their current situation.
The launch of the Casina program comes on the heels of a United Nations report that said Canada's temporary foreign worker program is a breeding ground for modern-day slavery. The initiative has for its partners the Battered Women's Support Services, which will provide legal support to the caregivers, and Collingwood Neighborhood House, which will provide the venue.
The vision is that we are a place to belong and a place to grow. So we could not be happier to be supporting Casina, this very important program to help folks who are the ones taking care of us.
That's a huge concern, that caregivers will lose their ability, their immigration status, their employment status. And that's why the benefit of a legal advocate is so important, because there are legal remedies. And having the benefit of a support person can help navigate that precarity.
Collingwood House is a place familiar to many caregivers. It is located in one of the most diverse neighborhoods in Vancouver and has been a solace for caregivers who want to bring their families here.
Nagugulat sila na may ganitong services. Nagugulat sila na, libre pala. They don't need to go to a consultant anymore kasi masyadong mahal din talaga. They always want to get their families.
Filipino-Canadian lawmaker Mabel Elmore says the BC government has actually increased the funding to create more legal clinics and resources to help caregivers. But she adds that many of these care workers still don't know how to access this help.
Migrant workers, temporary foreign workers, do have are covered by employment standards, which applies to all workers. The difficulty is because of their vulnerable status, often they don't know what their rights are, how to access it, or what avenues are available to them.
Vargas has been distributing leaflets in public areas to invite more caregivers to join their COSINA so they will know more about their rights and be able to successfully navigate their new life in Canada. Rowena Papasin, ABS-CBN News, Vancouver.